So today's topic will be the determination of CP in thermal analysis and what methods you can use to do the CP determination and how it's done. As this is a very frequent asked question and not so easy measurement, we thought it nice to have a webinar on this topic. If you already have an instrument and you are struggling with this measurement, you can afterwards contact us, can give you a little guideline and help and assistance as well. About myself, my name is Sebastian Seibt. Some of you may already know me. I'm working in the laboratory here at Linzai since 2013, and I'm mainly responsible for the calorimetric measurements, dilatometers, thermogravimetric analysis, and customer support as well as measurements. For those who do not know me or the company, a short slide about the company. Linzai is a German brand. We are a German manufacturer of thermal analysis equipment. We are placed right in the center of Germany in the northeast of Bavaria. And we have some facilities in the US and in China where we do repairs, support, and also measurements. We were founded in 1956 by this guy, Mr. Dr. Maximilian Linzai. And his son, Mr. Klaus Linzai, is our CEO nowadays. And his two sons, Florian Linzai and Vincent Linzai, are the management of the company at the moment. Our main products are instruments for thermal analysis in general. That means thermal conductivity, mass loss, dilatometry, and so on. And thermoelectric material, thin layer analysis, and so on, as well as the surface measurements I already mentioned. Then a short overview of our product range, just as a last slide for the introduction. This is the product range I just mentioned. And today our topic is the CP measurement, and the instruments that can measure the CP directly are marked red here. So you can determine the specific heat capacity CP by differential calorimetry, simultaneous thermal analysis, which is a combination of calorimetry and thermogravimetry, and the LFA, which measures thermal conductivity as well as thermal diffusivity and can calculate the CP. Just one second. Okay, so all the red marked instruments are used to determine the CP usually, and other instruments that I focus now. A short overview about today's schedule. So first of all, I want to introduce the specific heat capacity as a definition and what it is and how it can be determined. Then I will show you the methods I just mentioned, how to measure it, and the CP determination by DEC and LFA in detail. And then I will just show you some other mentions, some other measures that you can use for CP measurement. The definition of the specific heat to begin with is pretty easy. The specific heat can be read on Wikipedia or somewhere else. Specific heat of a substance is the amount of energy that must be added or taken up by the substance to heat one unit of mass for the substance for one unit in temperature. That means if you want to heat, for instance, 1 liter of water or 1 kilogram of water by 1 Kelvin, you need the energy amount of 4,182, so 4.18 kilojoule per gram per Kelvin to heat up the 1 liter water. And this is what specific heat means. So it's the amount of energy that must be used for a specific volume or specific mass of a substance to heat it for 1 Kelvin. You might already know it, or you might see it, the specific heat is temperature dependent. So it depends on the temperature of the substance that you are heating, how big or how low the CP value actually is. So it's a material constant, and for each material, it's a given value and you have to determine it by experiment. Just one thing I want to mention, specific heat is very often or frequently given as CP. Specific heat is usually described as just C. The P means it's measured at constant environmental pressure. So in a system with constant pressure, then you speak about the CP, the specific heat at constant pressure. In contrast, there's also a specific volume. That means if you change the pressure, but the substance volume is kept constant, you're speaking about the specific heat capacity at constant volume, which would be named CV. That's done very not so frequent. So therefore, we always speak about CP in thermal analysis. That's just that you have heard and seen that it's also a CV existing, and usually the heat capacity is just given as C. And the P always means you are working in a system with constant pressure, just that you have heard and seen that. I want to describe what the heat capacity in molecular view is and does to help you a little bit to understand why it's so complex to determine it and why it must be determined by experiment and it's not so easy to calculate it or not so easy to somehow simulate it. Therefore, you have to know that all matter, and no matter if it's a solid or liquid or whatever, consists of molecules, in some cases just atoms, like in gases like neon or helium or some of them. But in most cases, it's molecules. All these molecules are usually in a grid, or they are in a liquid just flowing around and can move. And in a gas, they are free at all and can move in every direction. And there is some space in between them. But nevertheless, they are all consisting of molecules. And these molecules, they are not standing still. They are rotating, vibrating. They are just moving. The grade, how fast they are moving and how much they are moving, is what we all know as temperature. The faster these molecules can move, the hotter the substance is. If they move very fast and the distance between them, these molecules gets bigger, it gets a gaseous state. If they are moving very low, it gets colder. And if they are frozen down to zero Kelvin, they would stand still, but that's, unreal. So in reality, they are all moving, all these molecules and atoms, and the faster they move, the hotter the substance is. This is just the general information you need to know. So the speed of the movement and the direction of the movement is what defines the temperature of the matter, just that you have heard and seen that. The movement itself, to have a closer look on the movement, there is a kind of kinetic movement. So the molecules themselves are moving and changing their position, which is a kinetic movement. And they have lattice vibrations. If they are in a solid state, they have vibrations. Even if they are not solid, but liquid or gases, they can vibrate, they can rotate, they can do stretching and strength and bending and stuff like that. So I have a scheme here. You can see in case of a CO2 atom or CO2 molecule, there's a certain bending. There is a symmetric stretching between the carbon and the oxygen atoms. There's an asymmetric stretching. There's rotation in one axis, rotation in another axis. There is a translational motion. So there is a lot of degrees in freedom. So that means directions these molecules can move to. And that's the point. The more directions and rotate axis a molecule has, the more energy it can take up, more or less, before the temperature is increased. So before this carbon dioxide molecule in this schematic example increases its temperature by increasing its kinetic movement, there's stretching and rotation in one direction, rotation in the other direction that has to be done first, more or less, before the molecule starts to move and changes its kinetic position. And each molecule, each substance has different degree of freedom, different angles, different axes. It can rotate, it can move. And they all have to be considered to calculate, or if you want to calculate the CP, all these axes and directions have to be considered, which makes it very, very hard to simulate. So the heat capacity more or less describes the amount of energy that is needed to get all these rotations, all these stretchings, all these bendings, all these movements going on before the molecule itself starts to vibrate as a total molecule. And this vibration is what the temperature makes, what the temperature is. So if you want to increase the temperature, you have to rotate the molecule, you have to get somehow vibration in the molecule, rotation, translation, whatever. And as every molecule is influenced by its neighbors, by forces of the neighbor molecules, that can be higher forces, lower forces, there's an electron transfer, maybe there's interaction, and so on. It's very hard to simulate, and it's very hard to calculate and understand how much energy you exactly need before the molecule vibrates. And therefore, CP is something that you have to do in an experiment. You have to do an experiment to determine the specific heat capacity of a specific substance or matter at a specific temperature. And the simulation, as I said, is very hard to obtain and very hard to do right. And therefore, CP is often or very frequently asked, and it has to be done by experiment, and it's not so easy. So far about the theory. The important fact I just mentioned is that the CP is, what you should somehow notice is that the CP is temperature dependent. It's defined by the molecular structure and the molecular environment of each material. And CP and CV both describe the heat capacity, but at different thermodynamic conditions. So CP is constant pressure in the system. CV would be constant volume of the system. One thing that I didn't mention so far, but which is very important, is during a phase transition, means melting or crystallization, the specific heat is infinite. It's defined as infinite because if there is a phase transition, if there is a reaction going on, the energy that the substance sees is consumed by the reaction and not by heating the substance. So therefore, by per definition, CP is infinite during a melting, during crystallization, during phase transition, or during chemical reactions. At that point, you will not be able to determine the CP. You will only see the reaction enthalpy. This is important to know. And the last thing I didn't mention, which is also an important fact, at higher temperatures, about 1,200 centigrades and higher, the infrared irradiation is mainly responsible for heat transfer. Up to that temperature, molecules start to vibrate and the vibration is transferred on the neighbor molecule. If you exceed around 1,200 centigrade, the vibration is no longer of that importance because the main energy is transferred then by irradiation. So the contact of molecules is less important, but the infrared irradiation and the electronic irradiation is responsible for the main part of the heat transfer. And therefore, at that temperature, it is very hard to determine the CP if you exceed this 1200 centigrades, just that you have heard and seen that. So far about the facts, and then I have some examples. There are some materials that have specific heat capacity values at room temperature or at standard conditions that are of interest. You all have to know that water has one of the highest specific heat capacities at all, around 4 at room temperature, which is very much. And then there are substances like metals. They have electron grid, and this electron grid can transfer electrons very, very fast and very frequently, leading to a heat transfer by electron transfer. And that means the specific heat is very low for most metals, because metals can easily exchange their electrons and therefore transfer the heat very fast. So you do not need much energy to heat a metal. You have air and gases that are in between around 1, and some other materials I just mentioned here. Graphite is around 0.7 at room temperature. Aluminum as a metal is around 0.9. Glasses are around 0.8. And then there's one important thing. Polymers, they vary. In this case, I have chosen an example of high density PE, which is around 1.9. There are polymers that are way below 1, and there are some around 2, depending on their density and the material they are made of. Just that you have just seen a few figures at room temperature, but as I said, the CP is temperature dependent, and by temperature, it can be increased, can decrease. It depends on the material. Just that you have a rough idea in what range a CP usually is. So far about the theory. The important and interesting part comes how to determine it. Just 1 second. I've been asked some questions. I will answer all these questions after the talk. Please just write them into the chat. I will just answer them when I finish. Okay, so how to determine the specific heat? The easy way to determine the specific heat is to use a constant temperature of your sample and use a classic bomb calorimeter or just a classic calorimeter. I just introduced to you how a classical calorimeter that's not used in thermal analysis, but that is used in chemistry or used in science, how it looks like. The setup of a calorimeter is pretty easy. You have an insulated, more or less, box. Within the box, you have a media, like in this case, water. This water has a stirrer to get a little bit convection in there, that the temperature is homogeneous in this water bath. And you have a thermometer that determines the exact temperature of this surrounding water. You're using not always water, but you use a liquid, in this case water, where the CP is exactly known. That's important. Within this surrounding media, you have a chamber, and this chamber is in a kind of reaction, or there's some igniters in there where you can transfer a definite amount of heat, or you can just ignite a sample. And then there's a little flask where you can put a sample in. This classical calorimeter is made for reaction of this sample, so to burn it off. So you can have an oxygen supply, put some oxygen in there, then you just ignite the sample, it burns off, and you determine the temperature of the water around it. The amount the water of temperature the water increases is the amount of energy that the substance releases. If you do not burn off a substance, but just put your substance in there and transfer a definite amount of heat in there, and then you do the same experiment, you will see that there is a heat increase in the water bath, and it's not the same amount of heat that was put to the sample. Out of the difference in heat of the surrounding water and the heat that you have given to the sample, you can calculate pretty easily the CP at the given temperature, at the temperature the sample has and the water bath has at the moment. So with this setup, you can determine large volume CP at room temperature or at temperatures around room temperature that are more or less given. So it's a fixed experiment that gives you the CP at one temperature. And the advantage is the bomb calorimeter that's used in that way to determine a specific heat capacity allows a pretty exactly measurement at exactly one temperature. So at room temperature, specific heat can be determined by experiment quite easily with considerable high accuracy. Just for those of you who are interested in theory, so the calculation is just the heat energy in joule per gram is the specific heat of the calorimeter, so the water, and then times the temperature difference, final temperature minus initial temperature, so just the temperature difference, like I just described. And out of this experiment, as I said, you can determine with a pretty high accuracy the CP of any substance at room temperature. The important thing is, as I told you, the CP is temperature dependent. So in thermal analysis, you are not interested usually in the CP at room temperature. You're interested in the change of the specific heat during your process, during heating, during cooling, and so on. And therefore, we have to take a closer look on the methods of thermal analysis that allow the determination of CP, which are calorimetry et al., the laser flash technique, and some other methods. I will just begin with the DSC, which is the most frequent method that's used. The CP determination can be done by DSC, and there are two options. So the Lindeis series has two options. We have a high temperature DSC that allows a measurement from room temperature to 1200 centigrades, where you are quite flexible in sample shape, and you can do linear measurements. And we have a so-called chip series with a smaller sensor, with a higher performance sensor that's limited to 600 centigrades, allows a lot smaller volume of sample, and allows a very fast modulated measurement. So you increase a little bit the accuracy, but I will show you in detail. I will start with the classic DSC. Maybe you all know that the DSC sensor looks like this on the screen on the top right picture here. A DSC sensor usually consists of a metal frame, mostly platinum or nickel or other thermocouple material frame. Within this frame, you have two positions for two crucibles. Usually a differential scanning calorimetry calculates the difference between two crucibles. So you have an empty reference side and you have a sample side. On both sides, you place a crucible. The crucible looks like on this picture below here. So it's a small cup. Usually the size is around 0.1, 0.2 milliliters. Our crucibles are 0.12 milliliters, by the way, and can be made of aluminum, platinum, gold, alumina. So you're not fixed to one material. It depends a little bit on your sample. You should make sure that your sample is not reacting with the material of the crucible. So this is the general setup. And this sensor and these crucibles are placed within a furnace. This furnace can be controlled. So it's a controlled heat release on these two crucibles. In ideal case, both crucibles see the exact same amount of temperature. You calculate, or the system calculates the difference in temperature between the two crucibles. And out of the difference, you get your DSC signal. So far about the DSC theory. If you want to do a CP determination, you have to do the following procedure. First of all, you have to run a series of blank correction curves using two empty crucibles. So you have an empty crucible on both sides. I'm just getting one slide back here. You place an empty crucible on both sensor sides, one on the left side, one on the right side, and you run correction curves. That means you just run a linear heating run up to the target temperature you want. So you cover the range you want to measure, maybe from room temperature to 1200 centigrade. It's necessary to do more than just one run, because sometimes there is some gas stored at the crucible surface. Sometimes there's gas within there on the surface of the sensor. Sometimes there's dust and dirt and whatever. So we recommend to run 2, 3, 4 samples one by one, and then you take the average value. So you get a correction like on the curve below. You get a series or a bunch of correction curves that should cover each other quite well, like you can see here. So if you have reproducibility like this on this example here, all is fine. After you did your correction runs to correct the background, you have to do a reference run. That means you have to run a known sample, a known reference with known CP at the exact same conditions like you did with the correction before. Usually we use a Sapphire reference. Why? The simple fact is that Sapphire is very well-known material, so you can order Sapphire from NIST or from ASTM with certified CP values over a whole temperature range up to 1,000 or 1,100 centigrade. This is the reason why we use Sapphire as a reference. The other reason is that Sapphire has a CP value around 1, which is right in the middle of possible CP values. So there's a lot of materials that are slightly below 1, joule per gram Kelvin, and some materials around 1 or in between 1 and 2 joule per gram Kelvin, but there's only a few materials much higher or much lower. So therefore you have a material that's right in the middle of the range, and it's very well known, so therefore it's the ideal reference. So you have to place this Sapphire disk on the sample side of your sensor. Just remember, you have one empty crucible for reference and one for the sample. So you place the Sapphire in the sample crucible, the reference remains empty. And then with Sapphire of known mass, you do the same experiment again. You do a couple of repetition runs. And after you have 2, 3, 4 Sapphire runs, they should all show you as well this good coverage, this good reproducibility. After you've done that, you should have some curves like on this curve below, some corrections and some Sapphire curves. If you did everything right, you should have a small gap between these curves. So you see the trend is the same for both curves and there is a more or less constant gap between them. So it should look like this. In a third step, you have to create a calibration now. You see there is a constant difference between correction and Sapphire. After you have run all these curves, you correct your Sapphire by the correction. So you subtract each other from the curves from each other. So the correction and the Sapphire are subtracted. And what comes out is more or less a zero baseline. So if you subtract them, the signal should be a flat line, but slightly different from zero. So the baseline will not be at zero, it will be shifted. So the difference of these two curves will be a flat line different from zero. And if there would be no Sapphire masks, the curves would cover each other and the difference would be exactly zero. But as you can see, the Sapphire is shifted from the empty run. And this shift is what is caused by the CP of the Sapphire. So this shift in curves, this shift between correction and Sapphire is what the CP of the Sapphire causes. Because this is the amount of heat, the Sapphire has to take up to reach the same temperature like the empty crucible. So therefore, out of the gap between the correction and the Sapphire curve, you can create the calibration by just subtracting the curves. And whatever comes out, this curve is slightly different from zero. So it's a linear curve, slightly different from zero. And the difference to zero is what is used as a calibration factor for your CP calibration. So the subtraction is done automatically, of course, by software. And out of this what result that comes out by the subtraction, you get a calibration file. This calibration file is stored. And in the third step, you have to run your unknown sample. So in the third step, an unknown sample must be measured following the same procedure, the same heating profile, the same type of crucible, the same experiment. And then when the unknown sample is measured, you do the same correction with the same correction curve like you did with the Sapphire. And then you apply the calibration you have created with your Sapphire curve. And out of that, you get your CP value. So far about the theory for the normal DUC. There are some requirements you should consider. First of all, the sample volume must fit into the crucible. It doesn't it's not useful if the sample is way bigger than the crucible, or it's just a tiny little portion of sample. So you should at least fill the crucible. It's around 40, 50 milligrams of sample that you need, depending on the density of the sample. Of course, you have to know the sample weight, because you have to type in the exact weight of the sample, otherwise the CPE measurement is wrong. The next fact that you should consider is that the sample has to contact the surface as much as possible. A flat surface is better than a rough surface. The ideal geometry for a CPE run would be a round disk with a flat bottom side that really contacts the crucible quite well. And you have to make sure that the sample does not react with the crucible material. There should not be a chemical reaction between sample or crucible, and there should also not be a phase transition in the measured range. If there is a phase transition during the measured range, then you have to know that during the phase transition, you will have a peak on your curve. So your curve will show a peak somewhere. And during that peak, you will not be able to determine the CPE. You can interpolate the data, but you will not obtain data during a peak. So if no good contact is possible, the sample preparation is important. You have to cut your sample, maybe you have to polish your sample, but you somehow have to make a good contact between your crucible surface and your sample. That the same for the sapphire. The sapphire reference should be a flat disk. That's why our sapphire reference looks like this. It's a small disk with a polished surface on top and a bottom that you can just put into the crucible. And the same for the sample. It is possible to measure powders, pastes, liquids, and whatever. Of course, liquids have good contact. With a liquid, you have to be very careful with the evaporation. And for powders, you have to compress and ideally press a tablet or something out of a powder. If it's too much air in between, the error on the CPE will be too big. The evaluation, that's what I did not show you. As I said, if you apply the calibration factor you've created with the sapphire on your measurement, then you will get a heat flow signal. So this is your raw signal. It's just a heat flow in milliwatt, slightly different from zero. And out of this heat flow, a CP signal will be automatically calculated and plotted. A C signal usually looks like this. You see, it's not a flat definite line. It's a little bit noisy. There's a little bit ups and downs. And this is how a CP signal on a DC looks like. The reason why it's so noisy and why there are some ups and downs and so on is simply that the DSC just considers a small amount of volume, and there are some convection effects, there are some gas effects in the system that all have an influence, and therefore the system has a certain error. We always state that the error on the CP measurement with the DSC is around 5 to 10% of the absolute value. And if you would repeat this experiment and do it like 3 or 4 times for one sample, you would be able to take the average value, and then out of the average value, you can calculate it as around 5% error, just that you have seen it. A few hints to improve the measurement. As I just mentioned, besides the contact, there's also some other facts that are important. One question in the chat was also if aluminum or alumina can be used for CPE determination. In general, you have to make sure that the heat uptake by the sample is given. So whatever the furnace irradiates on the sample should be taken up by sample and reference in a quite good way. Therefore, it's useful to use metal crucibles before you use, it's better to use them before you use ceramic crucibles. So alumina has a worse accuracy on CP, but in general, it's possible to use ceramic crucibles for CP measurement. So if your sample would react with every kind of metal, you can use a ceramic like alumina or zirconia, if there's no other way. But in general, metal crucibles like platinum, aluminum, or gold are better because the heat transfer from the furnace and from the irradiation of the furnace to the sample through a metal crucible wall is much better than through a ceramic, because ceramic is more or less an insulator. Now, if your sample has a very bad heat uptake, besides using a metal crucible, like in that case platinum, you can furthermore improve the heat spread by using a susceptor ring. So we have these rings that can be plugged on the sensor around this sample holder. Like you see on the right side, you see the sample holder. Now on the left picture, you see this platinum ring. So just imagine you stick it on top, and then you have this susceptor ring around the sensor head, allowing a better heat transfer and a better heat spread, because the susceptor takes up the furnace heat, spreads it around the sample very homogeneously, and then both sides, reference and sample side, see exactly the same amount of heat, and the heat transfer from the furnace to the sample is a little bit improved. This also lowers convection effects. Depending on the atmosphere you're using, and for CP measurement, I always recommend to use an inert atmosphere like argon or helium. Depending on the atmosphere, there's more or less convection. Each gas has a different thermal conductivity, so helium transfers heat much better than maybe argon or nitrogen. But argon or nitrogen allow a better measurement precise. And so if you use argon or nitrogen, the error of your CP measurement will be lower. However, you have more convection in the system. And the convection is bad for your results. So therefore, you have to compensate the convection, the spread of heat and cold gas zones, by using this susceptor and maybe also using a lid on the susceptor to get a clean and convection-free atmosphere. And you can furthermore reduce the convection effect by using a heat shield stack. Like you see on the right picture, there's the stack around the rod of the sensor containing these heat shields. These heat shields create zones of gas within the furnace where the gas convection is lowered. And this is really crucial because this improves your measurement. If you have very bad contact to the sensor or very much convection and a bad heat transfer, you should consider of do all these improvements because otherwise the CP can give you negative values or can give you values that doesn't make sense, that don't make sense. It's very important that you know what your CP might be and where it is roundabout or roughly. The reason is you have no control. So you will get a CP result if you do all these steps. Nevertheless, you do not know if it's right or wrong. You have no possibility to check if the measurement gives you the right value or gives you the wrong value. The only thing you can do is you can do repetition. You can do the experiment again and again and see the average value, see if there's a spread or see if the value is reproducible. And you can compare it to literature values. Sometimes the room temperature values are available and you are just looking for higher temperatures. So you can check if the values make sense. But it's very hard to just see from one measurement if your CP result is good or it's not good. And if it's not good, as I said, you can do all these improvements. And there's one thing that you should know. There's the so-called CP equation. It's the equation in bright blue letters down here that is, it's not a must, but it's an orientation for you. It says that the CP of your sample times the mass of your sample should be around the CP of your reference, in this case, sapphire, times the mass of the sapphire. So CP times mass of your reference must be more or less similar to CP times mass of your sample. So if you know that your sample has a very low CP, then you have to use a higher sample mass, and you can refer it to the sapphire roundabout. As I mentioned before, the sapphire is right in the middle of the possible CP range. If you have a metal with a very low CP, I'm sometimes using Inconel reference materials, but Inconel reference has the disadvantage that I have only literature proven values up to around 500-600 centigrades and not higher. But for metals, sometimes it's useful to use a metal reference. The same for graphite. For graphite, sometimes I'm using graphite references. It depends really on what you want to measure. The sapphire is a kind of universal reference material, but you have to play around with the sample mass. So you cannot influence the CP of your sample, and neither you can influence the CP of your reference, but you can influence the mass of your sample. And if you know that your CP of your sample is not fitting to the CP of your reference of your sapphire, you can increase or lower the mass of your sample until you see that there is no spread anymore, that there is no change anymore, and then you have found the right mass. So this, as I said, this equation is not a must, but it's an orientation to improve your accuracy and improve your results. As said, in ideal case, you are around 5% error over the full range, which is the maximum DEC can deliver. The other option would be the determination by the chip technique DEC. As I mentioned, we have a small DEC sample holder, kind of chip holder, where this sensor is transferred into a microchip with a microheater. The advantage is that your heater is now implemented into the sensor, so it's already contained. There is no external furnace, so the heating is directly transferred to the sample in a much better way than if you use an external furnace. The disadvantage is that your temperature range at all is now limited to around 600 centigrade, but the advantage is that you just have to place one crucible there. The reference is already within the sensor and the heat is also within the sensor. So the heat transfer is given to the sample as long as the sample is in good contact with the crucible bottom. And due to the low thermal mass of the sensor, the CP determination by chip DSC allows you one thing that's not possible or not so easy possible with the classical DSC. It allows you a modulated measurement run. The general procedure will still be the same. You need to do a correction curve, you need to do a sapphire reference curve, and you need to do a run of your unknown sample. So the procedure is the same. However, you do not do it linearly. You do not do linear heating, you do modulated heating. That means a temperature modulation can be applied like 1 Kelvin per minute up and down. So you get a kind of synodal heating curve. So you get a heating that goes up 1 Kelvin, down 1 Kelvin each minute. And at all, you heat 10 degrees per minute or even 20 degrees per minute. And within these 10 degrees or 20 degrees heating, you have a curve that goes up and down with a pretty high frequency. The trick is, this modulation on temperature results in a modulation on your signal. As you can see, your raw data, the blue curve here, has a certain modulation. It has an amplitude. The sapphire data, the green curve, has a certain amplitude. And the red curve is the sample data. The customer sample, in this case, has also the certain amplitude. The phase of all these amplitudes is the same. So the frequency is the same because the modulation was the same. But the height of the amplitude is different, as you can see. For the correction, the amplitude, so the height of this modulation is lower than for the sample containing runs. The reason is that the amplitude is directly influenced by the specific heat of your sample or specific heat of your reference. So out of the height of the amplitude, you can calculate your CP now. You do no longer need the difference between the correction run and the sapphire run, or the difference between correction and sample. So you just see the difference in amplitude. The advantage is it's much better and you have a higher accuracy. And out of that, you can, as well as for the linear run with the classical DSC, calculate the CP of your sample, of your reference. And in that example here, you see that the sapphire data, the green one, was transferred into the red sapphire curve, the yellow sapphire curve. So the measured CP of the sapphire follows more or less the literature value of the sapphire. And the unknown sample, but you can see there's some effect taking place around 20 minutes here, gives or results into the blue CP curve of the sample. Of course, during the first minutes, there's still a little bit noise because at the beginning of every run, you have issues with temperature control, but that's the same for linear heating. But after that, you get a pretty sharp curve. So this modulated run for the chip sensor has the advantage that you can have a CP accuracy around 3%, maybe even down to 1%, which is much better with the classical DSC. Or than the classical DSC can achieve. As said, for the modulated run, you're limited in temperature, but you have an accuracy around 1 to 5%, which is the best accuracy over a certain temperature range you will be able to achieve. As I said, instead of calculating the calibrating the difference in a linear baseline, a linear sample, you're now just checking the amplitude, and you get a much sharper signal. In that case, again, it's a experiment I did in the lab where I just checked the CP of a sapphire reference with the literature value and compared it, that you see that you're really pretty close to the literature value doing this modulated run. Down here, you see the raw data. Up here, you see the calculated CP out of the shift in the amplitude. So this is how a pretty fast and pretty accurate CP measurement can be done by DSC. Also for this chip DSC, also if you do modulated runs, there are a few requirements that you have to consider. You need good sample contact. This is still the most crucial part. You need a sample that covers the bottom of your crucible. Then you need a smaller sample volume and mass than with the classical DSC. I told you with the classic DSC, you have around to fill in 40, 50 milligrams. For the chip DSC, you're working around 1 to 50 milligrams because the crucibles are a little bit smaller. You're also limited to aluminum. You cannot use other stuff than aluminum because now you have the heater within the chip and the transfer of the heat from the chip to the crucible is only possible with a metal crucible. Of course, you could use platinum as well, But as the temperature range is limited to 600 centigrade, platinum would not make sense. You can use aluminum, which is much cheaper and easier to handle. And therefore, the sample volume is reduced, the maximum temperature is reduced. And there's another thing. For liquids and powders, it's very hard to do a modulated run because of convection within the sample. So in a liquid, the bottom of the liquid will see the heat, the top not, then there will convection be starting, and then you have evaporation of your liquid. So for liquids, it's very hard to get a GTP measurement done. And with powders, you can only measure powders if you press a tablet or if they are very density, high density powders. Otherwise, you're also here in the range about 10% accuracy of the CP, like in the classical DSC as well. So far about the DSC. Then there's another method you can use. I'm running slightly out of time because I was 50 minutes too late. I'm sorry for that. I will try to finish this a little bit faster than usually planned. The CP measurement by LFA is also a CP determination that's possible in general. For those who do not know how the LFA works, just in general, the LFA, which means laser flash technique, is an instrument that usually was designed for determination of thermal diffusivity. You can also determine the thermal conductivity if the CP is known or if you do a CP determination. In general, it works like this. You have a sample. The sample has a graphite-coated surface, and then you have a power source, in that case, a laser light. The laser beam light hits the sample with a short pulse from the bottom side. And on the top side, there is a detector, infrared detector, that looks on the top side of the sample and sees how much heat is transferred through the sample, how fast. That's the general setup. So you have a irradiation source at the bottom side, you flash at the sample, and on the top side, you see how fast the heat is transferred. The temperature of the sample is determined by thermocouple all the time. On this picture, you see how this sample holder looks like. So in the classic LFA, you can have three or six samples at the same time. They are heated by an external furnace, and then you do short pulses at a given temperature. You heat for a certain temperature, then you stop heating, and at that temperature, you pulse each sample with the laser source from the bottom side and detect the amount of heat that's transferred on the top side. Of course, you can use it for CP determination if you do a comparative measurement. Similar to the DSC, what you have to do is you have to place a reference material, a known reference, which can be a graphite, which can be a sapphire, like in the DSC, in one position. And on the other position, you have your unknown sample. Now, to understand how it's done, you have to know a little bit more about how the LFA evaluates its data. As I told you, you have a laser pulse from the bottom side, and the top side, you see a temperature increase. Usually, the raw signal of a pulse looks like on the screen here. At point zero, there's the laser shot. And slightly after zero, the temperature on the top side, what you see here is the temperature increase at the top side. So the temperature on the top side increases to a certain constant value. Of course, the time, how fast it increases, is given by the sample thickness and thermal diffusivity of the sample. The value where it stabilizes and the target value to what the temperature raises is a little bit given by the power, of course, of the laser, as well as the CP of the sample. So if you fire with the same power, with the same laser power on the sample and the reference, the exactly same amplifying factor, the exactly same pulse duration, the exactly same amount of energy. And now you fire at the sample and you fire at the reference, you will for sure see a difference in the heat raised of your sample and your reference. Of course, your sample and reference have to be the same thickness, otherwise the thickness would have an influence, of course. But if you have the same thickness, if you have the same energy amount, then you can compare the heat increase, so the height of this heat increase at the top side of your sample and your reference. And out of the difference in this temperature rise, you can calculate the specific heat capacity of your sample if you know the specific heat capacity of your reference. So this is just the text, how it's done. Determine the specific heat of the maximum of temperature rise of the sample as compared to the maximum temperature of the reference, like I just described. Both have to be measured under the same conditions, so the same energy, same thickness, same detector settings, and so on. And then you can follow this equation here, and out of delta T, you can calculate the CP of your unknown sample. So far about the theory. This is how you can, so if you get the CP value out of this equation. You can use it for this one. So CP of your sample is CP reference times temperature difference of reference times mass reference divided by mass of sample and temperature difference of sample. So far, so good. But the problem is that the emissivity of your sample and reference must be the same. That means if one sample takes up the heat of the laser pulse better than the other one or worse than the other one, the difference of temperature rates will have an error, a certain error. If you use the same coating for sample and reference, in our case, our example graphite, you can compensate it a little bit, but if you have a transparent sample or if you have a reflecting sample, it's still a problem. Also, if you just remember the equation I showed you for the DEC, the absolute heat capacity of sample and reference must be very similar. The reason is, if sample and reference are two, the same amount of energy will cause really totally different signals, and you have to modify the amplification factor of the detector, you have to modify the iris and the lens to get a similar signal. And the moment you have to modify the iris or the amplification, you cannot do this measurement, you cannot perform this measurement anymore. So this leads more or less to the fact that the reference and the sample must be of a very similar material, must be at least the same kind of material at the same density and thickness. Otherwise, the CP determination by LFA is very, very hard to obtain. It's also important that they have the same dimensions because the energy input is also depending on the dimension. So the diameter of the samples and thickness must be the same. That's what I already mentioned. The coating must be the same. The emissivity must be the same. The sample holder, of course, must be the same. And of course, all properties of the sample must be known, and especially the density, thickness, and CP of the reference must be known. And as said, sample and reference must have the same thickness. As said, this equation for the DEC is the same for the LFA, but for the LFA, it's much stricter. To be honest, the CP determination by LFA is very hard to obtain and for only a few samples. Most customer samples are unknown materials or compositive materials where you do not have an exact fitting reference. Sometimes you're lucky, you can use a reference that fits fitting regarding the behavior, the emissivity, the CP behavior, then you can do the experiment. But for most samples, for most unknown samples, the better way is to determine really DEC by CP and use the CP you get from the DEC experiment for the calculation of thermal conductivity by LFA. The problems for the LFA, as said, is the rough sample surface. So the sample surface must be pretty flat. Sample should not be reflective. Sample should not be transparent. That must be stable in the given temperature range. For the LFA, in contrast to the DEC, a phase transition is very, very deadly, I would say, because in the LFA, the sample is more or less free hanging in the beam. If it now melts or bends over, it falls down and then it's out of the beam. You cannot measure it anymore. In the DEC, if it's melting or doing a phase transition, it's not so tragic. So reactions should be avoided, phase transitions should be avoided, and the emissivity behavior is something you cannot influence just by coating. But if it's not enough to coat it, you will not be able to measure CP. To summarize this, the CP accuracy by LFA, if you find a fitting reference material, is around 5 to 20%, which is lower than the DEC experiment. However, the LFA has the advantage it can measure the CP to higher temperatures. So you can even exceed the 1200 centigrades because with the laser, you're a little bit more accurate than with the DEC resistance heaters. The only problem is that you really have to find a fitting reference, which is sometimes, especially if you cannot cut your samples or if you have a given sample shape and you cannot influence that, which is very hard. And this is why we very often say for CP determination by LFA, we need to have the sample in our hands and see the sample first before we can say if it's possible or not. I have also a curve how it looks like, just to mention that. If you do the thermal diffusivity run and you find a reference that's fitting, for in this case, it's a graphite sample with measured with a graphite reference, you can do the CP determination at several temperature steps. You get the CP curve, and then you get the thermal conductivity curve out of that. So this is what the LFA can measure if you find a reference that fits to your sample. And then I have the final two slides. Besides the LFA and the DEC, which are the techniques that we commonly use for CP determination, you can also calculate the CP If you have an instrument like the THB transient hot bridge device that can measure thermal conductivity and thermal diffusivity. The equation below is very important. So the thermal conductivity lambda is defined as thermal diffusivity alpha times the CP times the density. If you know three of these values, you can calculate the fourth one. So usually you can determine the density quite easily. If you now can measure thermal conductivity and diffusivity by, for instance, THB, you can calculate the CP value. Therefore, the error on the CP value is then depending on the accuracy of your thermal diffusivity and conductivity measurement. Both can be performed by THB by plugging these sensors in between a sample. For those who do not know the THB, you have this kind of Kapton foil sensors that are sandwiched between two pieces of sample. They have a heater in the middle that causes the heat spread within the sample. And out of the heat spread, you can follow the heat spread within the material. And there are some resistance wires that can detect the heat flow or the heat transfer within the sample in one area or in one direction. And out of this, you can calculate or you can measure the thermal conductivity directly. If you know exactly how thick your sample is, you can get the thermal diffusivity as well. And out of these two values, you can calculate the CP. That works for solids. It roughly works for liquids. It doesn't work for powders, unfortunately. A CP run can look like this. So you can determine the thermal diffusivity, thermal conductivity. And as I said, if the density is known at each temperature, you can calculate the specific heat out of that.